Penguin Random House Audio presents The Watermen, the birth of American swimming and one young man's fight to capture Olympic gold, by Michael Loynd. Read for you by Will Damron. To my family, they make everything worthwhile. What stands in the way becomes the way. Marcus Aurelius. Prologue. 15,000 British spectators gathered inside London's Olympic Stadium to see if the human fish could actually crawl on top of the water. Despite the morning rains, the crowds came on a cloudy July afternoon in 1908 to bear witness to what newspapers on both sides of the Atlantic had been writing about over the past 2 years. But when the young American walked onto the damp lawn, he didn't look anything like a fish. He wore a dark blue swim cap over his short blonde hair, a heavy, navy-colored wool bathing suit that stretched from shoulders to knees, and a long white robe that moments later would be at the center of an international scandal. At a time when only top royalty and powerful heads of state were known beyond their country's borders, the name of the so-called American fish, Charles Daniels, was on people's lips throughout North America, Europe, and Australia. No one quite knew where he came from. The origins of his swimming prowess remained equally mysterious, and whatever fueled his unlikely rise was made all the more inexplicable by the fact that almost no one in America swam. The country's measly 600 competitive swimmers had been discarded as laughingstocks compared with the superior Europeans. Yet somehow, this 23-year-old, who admittedly could not muster a decent stroke 4 years earlier, held every American swimming record from 50 yards to the mile. He had willed into being the first U.S. Olympic swim team, invented the modern-day freestyle stroke, popularized an obscure sport whose minimal attire and openness to all genders challenged the day's narrow-minded Victorian attitudes that oppressed so many. And now, he claimed world records in the sport England had invented and dominated for the past 70 years. The sport's supreme authority, England's Amateur Swimming Association, denounced him as a fraud, refusing to validate his achievements. And what had begun 4 years earlier as a personal struggle to overcome crippling anxiety and improve his and his mother's bleak existence now placed him at these fourth Olympic Games with the chance to accomplish what no one believed possible, becoming the first non-British swimmer to seize the world's number one ranking. America loved a winner. What Charles didn't realize was that London's Olympic organizers were conspiring to ensure that never happened. The European champion was already rumored to be posting world record times after copying Daniels' unique crawling technique. With a body forged from steel, an incredible wingspan, and a shaved head that signaled he was all business, the European champ had beaten him during their first encounter at the 1904 Olympics, then won again last year at the 1907 English Championships, this time with the underhanded help of the same British swim judges who now officiated these London Games. The fact that the Olympic officials were all British presented a major conflict of interest that the International Olympic Committee would never allow to happen again. The Brits operated all the stopwatches. They made the call on close finishes. Any complaint filed by the American team over the British referee's hometown bias or blatant cheating was ruled upon by the same British officials. Unless he won by a clear margin, the opportunity for the judges to rule in another competitor's favor remained very real. And Charles needed to do more than just win. To leave no room for the British Empire's swimming authorities to again dismiss him, he had to break their world record, which they had made more difficult by designing an outdoor pool 4 times longer than any concrete tank in the world, twice as long as what would become standard for a modern Olympic-sized pool. Its 100-meter length eliminated Charles's superior off-the-wall turning advantage that the British press insisted was the only reason he could ever defeat one of their champions. On top of that, England's Olympic officials randomly assigned him to the farthest lane, the hardest position to hear the starting call or see one's opponents, and the most likely spot to face more resistance from the displaced waves rebounding off the side wall and back onto the swimmer. Yet, despite all these disadvantages, they sneaked in one final measure to guarantee his defeat and extinguish his growing legacy. A sense of anticipation buzzed inside the stadium as Charles walked across the grass in front of the King's Royal Box and onto the wooden starting deck of the infield's pool to begin the 100-meter race. All of his teammates had met defeat at the hands of Britain's superior watermen, and other than a tiny section of flag-waving countrymen relegated to the stadium's far corner, the entire crowd hoped to see the American fish defeated. The official starter, a mustachioed Brit named Mr. Hudson, called out, "Take your marks," to signal the swimmers to remove their robes. Charles had his robe half drawn off, listening intently for Mr. Hudson's next call, "Are you ready?" But the next word from Mr. Hudson was, "Go!" Every opponent vanished. Charles's head whipped around in panic as he realized the trick. Loud splashes and the fast-departing churn of water exploded beneath him. His competitors had all been forewarned. They now had an insurmountable head start, while Charles was still yanking his arms out of his sleeves. Mr. Hudson and his fellow officials grinned. The American fish was defeated before he got wet. The officials knew it. Everyone in the stadium knew it. But as Charles ripped off his robe and dove into the water, he knew only that he was in for the fight of his life. Part 1. Drowning. 1. The Drowning Boy, 1896 to 1899. The path that led Charles Daniels to the water that day was a long, hard, thorny bushwhack that he should never have survived. Some said it started with a handful of misfits at the New York Athletic Club fantasizing about defeating the unbeatable British Empire. Others claimed it began with a mother and son fighting to keep each other from financial and social ruin. Charles never forgot the first time he saw the word that would become his destiny. It was a cool April morning in 1896. He was 11, inhaling the sweet smell of newsprint and fresh ink. Under the yellow hue of his apartment's gas lights and chandeliers, he sat in a spot where he often lost himself in reports of athletic triumphs. Out of New York's 15 daily English-language newspapers, sports aficionados like Charlie preferred William Randolph Hearst's Journal because, unlike other papers that lumped news together like goulash, it introduced the then revolutionary concept of a section dedicated entirely to sports. Charlie flipped through those pages, combing through every article about athletic contests. There was one on Harvard's track men fighting through back-to-back defeats against Princeton and Columbia. Another about Yale's oarsmen training for the Grand Challenge Cup of the prestigious 57th Henley Royal Regatta in London, which no American team had ever won. The Brooklyn Bridegrooms were preparing to kick off the professional baseball season in front of thousands of anticipated fans in the wooden bleachers at Eastern Park. And then, near an ad claiming any person was behind the times if they did not join New York City's 15,000 other telephone subscribers, appeared an utterly foreign headline: The Olympic Games. Like most people at the time, Charlie had never heard of an Olympian. The sound of trolley cars, horse carriages, and pedestrians below the apartment window faded as he read on. The short article described a seemingly mythical stadium in Athens with a mind-boggling 50,000 gleaming white marble seats that stretched beautifully to the sky, with 50,000 more spectators sitting on a hillside overlooking the venue's basin. The image seemed lifted straight from Greek myth. The concept of a stadium had been lost to history, not since the last ancient stadiums of the Greek and Roman empires crumbled to ruin.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.